One, two, three. Action! Okay, what is up guys? Fam here with Zah once again. And today we have Philip. How are you, man?
Good, good.
How are you? Thank you for approaching us to do this bike review with us. Your bike, the Suzuki DRZ 400.
Yeah, no problem.
And you know, back in my days when I was at ITE, it was a cheap magnet. What do you think, Zah?
Yeah, at the height, I still remember, at the height of its popularity, this bike was almost like everywhere, you know. You turn left and right, you see, DRZ.
And just now I confused the classification actually. They always say this one is a scrambler. But what is it actually?
It's a motard.
Motard. Where did the name scrambler come from?
The scrambler, I don't know where you get the term scrambler. I mean, the scrambler
is... They always say this one is scrambler.
Maybe because the body is the scrambler type of a body, but the wheels are racing tires.
Okay lah. So motards are meant to go off road, right?
Well, technically, it's not supposed to be off road, but the supermoto race includes an off road section. So the circuit, supermoto circuit, there is like 50-70% tarmac, right? Then the rest is dirt.
So never mind. I don't really watch motocross. So before Philip actually gives a bit of background about the Suzuki DRZ 400, we're gonna give a bit of background about it.
The Suzuki DRZ 400 SM is a motard variation of the DRZ 400, a popular dual sports class of motorcycle. Launched in the year 2000, the acronym DRZ stands for Dakar Rally Zeta, and the SM variation, which came out in 2005, stands for Super Motard. It remains a popular dirt bike in Australia and the United States. Engine is a 298cc, single cylinder, liquid cooled, 4 strokes, DOHC 4 valve, with fuel injection and a 5-speed manual transmission. In Singapore, the Suzuki DRZ was once a popular model, but has since dwindled to being an obscure model, much like Suzuki itself.
Okay, so brother Philip, how I understand that you own this for 3 years.
Three and a half years.
So, at the time when you bought it, how much was it and why did you bought it?
So, when I bought it, it has about 4 years COE left.
4 years.
Okay. So, I got it for about 6.5k. That was quite a good price.
Okay.
Yeah,
at that time. So, right now, left 1 year.
I think less than 1 year already.
Oh my god. It's really a dying breed, Azhar.
It's getting a bit worrying. You know the COE prices now.
Yeah, true. I mean, you intend to own this for another like 10 years?
Yeah, definitely. We'll renew.
Okay.
That's surprising to hear. Usually in Singapore, after the COE expire, they won't care to renew one.
Yeah, because of the COE prices, right?
Riders usually buy a new bike from our understanding.
Does it have sentimental value to it so much that you want to continue using it for another 10 years?
Yeah, exactly. So this is pretty much one of the reasons why I got this bike. So just a interesting fact. This is actually my first bike, so I never rode a 2B bike.
You're like Mamprit, man. The rare breed of riders that jump from class 2E straight to class 2A.
It was like this when I first got into bikes, I kind of found out pretty early on that I really wanted a supermoto. The whole concept of it, like it's lightweight, it's okay if you drop it, like nothing's gonna break, right? So it's actually quite fuel efficient. It's powerful, it's good for city riding, which basically Singapore is all city riding.
Really?
So
this one, fuel efficient.
It is fuel efficient.
Because I always, my friends in ITE were complaining. I know my classmates, they own the DRZ 400. They say that this one is a gas guzzler.
Oh, is it?
I don't know. Maybe the young time, they like to whack the bike.
Maybe they whack or they modify the engine. Who knows?
Could be. They say that they use a lot of fuel and all that, but like you say. So, just a bit of background for myself, this bike, cheap magnet, I always see my classmates, they bring girls behind, you know. In the day. Is it the same for you?
Well, yeah, it's true. Same for me also. At one point of time, actually, there is an urge for me to upgrade to 2A and then get a DRZ, you know. There was a... But then again, after being so... I consider the cost of owning a bike back then, then I think, okay, I just stick to 2B.
Not only that though, the Suzuki DRZ, this is what a scrambler is supposed to look like.
Okay.
I don't know lah. During my era lah, I guess.
It's the most common one lah.
The most common one. Now we have what? WR155.
That one is a scrambler.
That one's scrambler.
This one is a motard. The murtad, you know. It's not a scrambler. It's not a racing bike. But it has the combination of both. You know, if you watch the races, they can actually lean, you know, in the corner with this bike. I'm surprised,
you know.
I'm surprised.
Even a high wheelbase, huh?
Yes, I'm surprised. A tall bike like this, you can actually corner baring, you know, lean into the corner. How do you describe its performance compared to the other bikes that you have rode before?
Okay, so maybe a bit of context. So far, the bikes that I've ridden before, mostly driving school bikes, huh? The 2B, the YBR, CDC 2A used to be also a YBR 250. And then my class 2 was the BBDC NC 750.
Yes.
So amongst all those bikes, right, I'll say that this bike it's very talky. I know it's a cliche, it's very talky.
Yes.
Extremely talky. And it's very light. So these two things, right, it makes it fun. So it's a fun bike. If you ask me about the performance, right, it's really fun. Right. It's a performance bike, it's fun. So it's lightweight, right? Let's say compared to the NC. The NC is actually quite talky also.
Yeah, correct.
But it's heavy. So when you sit on the NC, right, you try to throw it around a bit.
Yeah.
You feel the weight moving around. It's a bit reluctant.
It's true.
So I remember one of the lessons, my first few lessons at BBDC, after riding NC for about 1 hour, 2 hours like that, right? So it was like, I got back on my bike, like bicycles. it really felt like a bicycle. It's like, shit, it corners really fast. So the torque is another thing lah. So for city riding is good. You're basically going start stop short distance. You don't have to maintain high speed. Right. So basically off the line is pretty much as fast as any other bike lah. Yeah. Okay. Pretty much no worries there. You won't get caught up with cars or other trucks or that. Yeah. So really very ideal for Singapore lah, performance wise.
Philip, what's your height?
My height 173 if I remember right.
Yeah. And this thing. Is it okay for you? You think short people can go on top of it?
Short people, I think height is not really an issue. Maybe at first it's a bit intimidating.
It is intimidating.
I have seen some really much shorter riders than me ride this, no problem.
I have seen on the streets years back, lady rider, she rode a DRZ and she's tiptoeing at the traffic lights.
You know, the ballet tiptoe.
Yes!
Ballet tiptoe.
Oh my god, it's so like, I behind her, I'm like, oh my god. I cannot
see. Very tiring.
Imagine if you want to go JB, lama.
I rather I get down, I push.
That's what some of them do.
Oh my god, but I think if you love the bike, you don't care, you short or what, you will still ride it lah.
You get used to it. You get used to the
height. Yes, correct.
Yeah. For me, I just need 1 foot on the ground can really. Most of the time.
And then for you, the riding posture, is it comfortable for you?
Posture.
In terms of the handlebar, when you sit down.
Yeah, so I really like the posture myself. I know different people like different things. But for me, it's very comfortable lah. It's you could say it's good ergonomics lah, right? When you sit, you're like back straight, arms out like that. There's really not much pain.
Doesn't put any strain on on your back or whatsoever.
No strain.
I see.
Yeah, very comfortable.
Okay.
So how is the fuel consumption like? How big is the tank?
The tank is advertised, I think 9 or 10 liters. Usually I pump at 7 point something to 8 liters. Yeah. So that will take me about 200 to 220 km. So usually I track my fuel consumption. If I ride it hard, it's about 24 kilometers per liter. If I just take it easy, 28.
Okay.
So it's actually pretty good for 400 cc.
Yeah. I'm surprised when he said that, because I was thinking it was a gas guzzler, you know. Fuel guzzler.
And like I said, my friends, my classmates, they were using this, they say it consumes a lot of fuel.
I think I know why.
Why?
Because they haven't worked full-time yet. They work part-time, that's why.
They work part-time delivery,
Just to pay off the bike.
KFC, Pizza Hut on this bike, you know. After school, they work, firing, sir.
So that's why if they work full-time, they will say, very fuel efficient. But because they work part-time, every time want to top up. That's why they say, a lot of petrol.
One thing also I have to add, it's talky lah, right? It's good for short distance, stoplight to stoplight, right? So the one weakness I feel this bike, the one thing you cannot do.
What's that?
High speed highway cruising.
Ah.
But that's only if you really want to go to Malaysia lah, right? North South Highway. I've done it a few times, it's not nice.
It sucks.
Is really it because it's it doesn't cut through the wind?
Yeah, it doesn't cut through the wind. You get hit by the wind like the entire time. And also, the engine is not really made for high speed lah. So the gearing is very short. The accelerate is quick, right? But above like 100, 110, you can hear it really starting to... It's working extremely hard.
So right. So highway cruising is actually put pressure on the engine.
Yeah, I think it varies from bike to bike. For mine, it's about 100, 110 is my comfort level with it. Some people take it to 130 all day long, no problem.
That's right. I heard one of my friends, he rode to Melaka on the DRZ. He said, really cannot tahan. Because like you said, you mentioned, it's not made for highway cruising. After he come back, I think he went for few times. He come back, he have to overhaul. It strain on the engine.
So high speed takes its toll on these kind of bikes. The oil capacity is quite small, so high speed running burns the oil.
How many engine oil?
1.7 liters.
Quite small.
And then what is your maintenance schedule like?
So maintenance, because I mostly use the bike highway lah. I don't take it short distance. Like to light. I do it every 2,500 km. And it's usually still quite okay. So the recommended interval, if you do like stop start all the time, delivery or what, right? It's about 1,500 km. You should do an engine.
For yourself, you commute to work lah, usually.
Yeah. So it's very easy on engine. Doesn't really heat up.
Okay, so let's talk about accessories on your bike right now.
I know some riders they actually accessorize, they customize the body. Sui, you know. Very
all,
nice.
They put number here. They put sponsor. Sponsored by them, I don't know. And then for yourself, I see you have this bag here.
Oh yeah, okay.
Oh my gosh, this is just interesting.
Yeah, handlebar pouch lah. Very useful. A lot of things, I keep a few tools in here. My sunglasses, screwdriver, spanner, skipper ties. So one thing about this, right, if you go to Malaysia, your passport, you just here. Anything you need, right, your phone sometimes, you don't need to get wet.
And then what is this wires jutting out here?
Oh, this is the brake line, front brake line. So for scrambler, motor bikes, right, they have this.
Oh, so it's by default, it's like this, like you cannot hide it or what?
I mean, you can lah, but that's not how it comes. Some people pull it down.
And then what the heck is this?
Because
I remember just now I pushing the bike here to Lenny the frame. These numbers appear. You know?
Yes, this is aftermarket Trail Tech meter.
The speedometer lah.
Speedometer. So the original stock one, right? There's a problem with DRZs, right? So because we Singaporeans, we tend to take the bikes to their max mileage. The original meter that comes on DRZs will max out at 99,999. So once you pass that, right, you cannot use the trip meter, it doesn't work anymore, it's basically just a speed meter.
Seriously?
Yeah. I see, okay.
So that is actually quite an important thing, because you know for a DRZ there's no petrol gauge. So you cannot count your trip, you don't know when you need to top up. I put on an aftermarket one. So this thing, it sort of lights up whenever it detects wheel movement. So that's why you saw the numbers come out.
How does it detect? Just curious.
Oh, it's a
meter lah. It's a sensor lah.
Oh, the sensor.
Okay.
You have to show me later. Okay, so domino grips. I think by default, does it have the handle guards?
No, it doesn't. This is aftermarket Zeta grips lah. Which I bought second hand lah, very cheap.
And I noticed the hoses.
Yeah, hoses. Aftermarket hoses.
All aftermarket lah.
Yeah, coolant hoses. So the brake line is also aftermarket. Braided brake line.
Is it better?
It feels better, so apparently the standard rubber brake lines, right, get a bit spongy after a few years. That's just the nature of the rubber lah. So if these people put on these kind of stainless steel brake lines, you get that brake feel lah. It feels firm, it doesn't go soft after. So front and back lah, the back also has.
And also got base plate here. Fun fact, Philip actually removed his box before we record this video. Because it looks nicer. Scramblers, usually you don't see them. Motards. Motards, you don't usually see boxes on them. But in terms of accessories for the DRZ, even though in Singapore it's a dying breed, do you think there's a lot of it?
For the DRZ, it's quite an established model. About 20 years history behind this model. So if you talk about accessories, a lot, definitely a lot. In the US, they actually still sell this brand new, so you can get this kind of stuff.
Oh, it's still in production.
Still in production.
Oh, I didn't know that,
US. Yeah.
It's just in Singapore, it's not really, yeah, COE kills it off. Just now you mentioned the bad thing about the stock speedometer, right? Yeah. What other things beside the speedometer and the lack of fuel gauge, what other thing in this bike that is a con?
It's a con, okay. Wind protection. Mm-hmm. If let's say you are someone who does long distance very often, the wind protection, it gets quite tiring after a while, like your neck, you get a very busy neck.
Yeah, correct.
Really build your neck muscles. Mm. What else? The vibration. Same thing. If you ride highway for very extended periods of time, the vibrations through the bars, through the foot pegs, it gets very numbing.
Is it hot?
Yeah,
is the engine hot
situations?
It will get a bit hot if you like idle at a stoplight for very long. Once you move, it cools down very fast. So not really hot.
So mechanical issues of the engine. Is there any inherent problem with the engine or any other riders that have shared before?
Okay, I think one very common issue for DRZs in Singapore is the neglected oil changes lah. So if you don't do your oil changes on time, the impact can be quite severe lah. You can even go up to like engine overhaul kind of thing.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Engine wise, it's quite problem free lah, I would say.
Robust.
Yeah. Robust. The earlier DRZs, they had a problem with their cam chain tensioners. So there were a lot of aftermarket solutions for this, but the new ones, okay lah, no problem.
I see. Interesting. So,
Very reliable lah, I would say.
So under your 3 years of ownership, it hasn't give you any major problems or what?
Well, that's a story behind that. So,
care to tell us, please?
So there was one major breakdown lah. So there was this time where the coil failed, the charging coil. Right. So this thing, it goes almost instantly. There's no warning. Right. So there was this time I was sending a friend back, and on the way back, it cannot start. I had to push start it home, and I rode it home that day.
Ooh.
So the next day, right, I had to crank. It didn't start. I tried push starting, I think for like half an hour, 1 hour like that. You can see the mileage increased by like 1 km. I was push starting it.
Oh my god.
Round and round in the car park. It didn't want to start. So in the end, I had to get a friend to come and help me jump start with his car. Rode it over to the workshop, and I first thought it was just a battery. Turns out it's a coil. So yeah, a coil is one of the other weak point. The DRZ lah. So after a certain number of years, they will fail, so it stops charging the battery. And basically you can't, the bike will die lah.
But I think a coil problem is normal for most of the motorbikes. Even when I was riding my Vespa, after maybe about 3 years, 4 years, there will be problem with the coil.
It's a wear and tear issue.
It's a wear and tear issue.
Maybe to do with our climate also lah.
Probably also.
So for yourself, where you go to, do your servicing or maintenance with the bike?
I think a lot of people know of this workshop. The sticker on the front fork, Raptor Motorsport. DRZ specialist.
So really? Yeah, they're specialist in DRZ.
So
for him, he works on almost exclusively DRZ.
So his workmanship is tip-top?
He knows the bike inside out.
He's well-versed with the machine. But for yourself, you don't go to any ape-ape shop or shops that you don't trust?
So ever since I got this bike, the previous owner has been doing with Raptor. I just continue lah. Anyway, it's only once every few months, not a big deal lah.
So speaking of you going to that same shop, right?
Yeah.
Is there a DRZ 400 community in Singapore?
Community? Actually, so far I haven't really found anyone.
Huh? Really?
Maybe have, but I haven't found it.
There are still a few on the roads lah. I do still see them around, but it's died down already.
Yeah, my colleague at work, he rides a DRZ. I did actually ask him, hey, you want to interview, be in our videos? he's reluctant lah, he's shy lah.
Don't force lah, shy don't need lah. Philip, have you bought this off-road? Just curious.
A few times.
Wow. How's the experience like off-road?
I'm not very experienced off-road. And it's actually quite forgiving for beginners like me.
I see.
Right. So I went with a group of friends I met online. And they're all quite experienced. They had like big bikes, all that. So basically, they were all like there with dirt tires, all that. Then I come up with this.
Street tires.
Yeah. So it was actually quite okay because the bike is light. It is actually quite light. It's about 140 kg. Yeah. So it feels heavy when you push it around because the CG is high lah. But actually, when you ride it, it gets very. Once it's moving, it's actually quite light. So very easy off road, up and down. Gravel is okay. These kind of tires, once you go into mud, it's basically.
Wobbly lah.
You struggle a lot lah. The bike will fight you lah.
Where you went to go to off road that time?
Oh, that time the guys I went with, they had their own spot, so they found it themselves. Somewhere off Johor lah. Somewhere outside of Johor.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's this like plantation area, yeah. Abandoned quarry.
I would love to try off-roads, yeah.
You should.
Yeah.
Oh, there was one guy who went on his NC750. Can also.
Can also lah. Yeah. Yeah, but I don't know. We'll see. And for yourself, you when you go touring on this bike, how's the experience like? Just curious.
How's the experience Oh, it's tiring lah.
Tiring.
So it vibrates a lot after a while. The seat vibrates a lot lah, so your ass gets numb.
The seat is very small.
Seat is small, yeah. So there is actually an option where you can get a wider seat and all that. People do that lah, but for me it's okay. For me it's okay. Actually it's been broken in. It's pretty much soft enough. I find it okay lah. Good lah. So touring with this bike, I wouldn't recommend it. Get something like a 4-cylinder or something if you can.
How far you go? Just bike. Curious. Huh? How far you went to?
I've been for this is Mersing only lah, day trip.
Okay lah, at least you saw the pillboxes, right? That's interesting. You wanted to go to Mersing. I think Zah before he came back wanted to go Mersing.
Yeah, before the lockdown, actually wanted to go Mersing. You know, I really wanted to go Mersing because on the Malaysian Prime Minister on Sunday he announced the lockdown on Sunday. I was thinking, yeah, Monday or Tuesday I want to go for a ride lah, one last ride before the lockdown I want to go for a ride When I told my wife, yeah, I want to go for a ride to Mersing. For what? I was like, okay. What is the best memories you had with your bike?
Best memories
Your 3 years of ownership.
Wow, hard to say I really had a lot of experiences with it. But I'd say the day I got it lah.
That's like the best memory for everybody
Is it?
For all, most of the riders.
Standard answer.
Standard answer.
Yeah, because for me it's really been like a bike I aspired lah. Since to be, I knew that I wanted a DRZ lah, and I had to wait 1 year for that 2A test.
I'm just curious if the WR155 was released at the same time you passed your 2B, would you get the WR155?
That would be very tempting though. if they did a motard version. I like supermoto.
So that's the reason why you want to continue this for another 10 years?
Yeah. So to me,
I think just go ahead lah.
Yeah.
Just go ahead lah.
Go ahead.
Because you love it, then go for it lah.
Yeah.
But I feel that this one, my personal opinion the older the bike gets, the parts availability will be an issue. I think so lah. In my personal opinion.
But he mentioned that the US still still in production. So there is parts.
So lucky lah. Lucky
lah. Heng.
Yeah. So I have considered actually quite a few different bikes lah. When you get a Class 2, you say like, oh shit, maybe I should upgrade. Right. So ultimately, all comes back to this lah. This is the best all-rounder I can, I can really like find in Singapore lah.
I see.
Which is why I really wanna.
So let's say, you know, you already had an eye for a Class 2 bike. What will that be?
For a Class 2 bike,
Hypermotard.
Wah. Actually, that is true. Hypermotard.
Oh my god, we just revealed one earlier,
Just earlier.
That's a nice bike.
but you really need deep pockets,
Is it?
But it's very expensive.
Looking forward to the review,
Yeah.
Another one is the MT09.
Ah.
The SP version with the upgraded suspension on it.
Oh, I see.
And that bike is actually quite motard bias, which is kind of close to what I like.
So you like naked bikes,
Yeah.
For me, I like flaring. I like half flaring like mine. That's me lah. I'm not sure in the next few years the DRZ400 will still be around, given that it's a dying breed in Singapore. But who would you recommend this bike for? You know, for Class 2A riders.
I feel it's...
Who would you say it's for? That's what I mean.
Who would I say it's for? I think everyone should give it a try. A lot of people, they are put off by the height.
Height.
It can be quite intimidating, but really it's a very good all-rounder bike lah for Singapore, I would say. There's no more suitable bike that you can find. If you like a more relaxed riding position, if you like something that is stocky off the traffic light, if you don't have to do long distances very often, and maybe we don't have to pillion someone very often, it's very uncomfortable.
Speaking of pillion, Philip's girlfriend is over there. Sorry.
So overall, I wouldn't trade it for any other bike.
You really love this bike.
Cool.
Yeah.
You really love this bike. I'm sure you will renew the COE.
Is there any name for it?
Actually, don't have a name.
Oh, okay.
The DRZ.
You know, some people actually give a name. You know, actually put a name.
Like me, Hidayah, Emelina. Then that one guy, the GSR 400, what's his name? Rupert.
Oh, Bluebird.
I don't have anything. Speaking of sentimental value, right? Yeah. I think it's, for me, I put a lot of effort into this bike. I don't know if it's apparent or not. Mm. But the plastics, all that, I actually wrapped them myself.
Mm. So it's a wrap?
Yeah, it's a wrap.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see the,
so,
the...
Some parts not so good. I can see that it's
What's
a
its original color then?
It was black, but faded to grey.
Oh,
so,
like, overtime,
almost like completely grey.
I think cover set you can buy online.
Yeah.
Why buy when you can
do it, yourself.
Do it on yourself?
It's very rare in Singapore to find people doing it themselves or with their bikes. Even that guy, what's his name, Knife, in the WR55, he did most of the modifications himself, you know. That is very good. For me, I don't dare to touch my bike. I don't know. Scared, I like put touch a brake.
Boom!
Okay, guys. So, Philip, thank you so much for coming out and sharing your DRZ 400 with us.
Thank you.
Once a cheek magnet on Singaporean roads, during my time at least.
Yeah, during my time also.
Yeah. But yeah, sad to say it's a dying breed in Singapore lah. But hopefully through you, maybe it will live on, you know?
At least this one.
At least this one. So that's it for the vlog. Any riders want to review their bikes with us, do get in touch with us on our social media pages below.
DRZ riders out there, if you have anything else to add to the comment, if you have any experience or knowledge regarding this bike, put it in the comment section below. Like and share this video with your riding kakis, and don't forget to subscribe.
Okay, ride safe and stay safe. And yeah, that's it for the vlog, and we'll see you next one. Awesome, thanks. Alright.